Hello again out there in remote learning land. Today's hot topic, we're talking about how to affect the rates of evaporation, right? We're getting into humidity's effect on the atmosphere, how that relates to weather prediction. So that's where we're going today. Don't forget, the quarter is coming to a close. Make sure you get any in any delinquent labs. I got to start calculating grades. So anything that's not in goes down as a zero, and that's going to hurt your overall average quite a bit. All right. All right, let's get to it. This first clip here, you can try at home if you're very careful, of course. The air has to be extremely cold and dry for this to work. And you'll see the water instantaneously evaporate. It makes this like little cloud. But again, word of caution, you have to use very hot water. So if you do try it, make sure you throw it where nobody else is around and you throw it away from you, not straight up over your head, or you're going to get burned. If some of it doesn't evaporate. All right, watch carefully. Pretty neat little trick here.
What are you doing, Sam?
So what I've done is boiled water in the kettle. So it's boiling water. I'm going to pour it in here.
And then throw it in the air, and it's going to evaporate. Ready?
Oh, wow. That's amazing.
Usually, if it was warm, it would go plunk in the snow.
That's so cool.
It's like instant fog.
I know. That's crazy.
So pretty wild stuff, right? Instantaneous evaporation. Again, the air has to be extremely cold and dry, and the water has to be extremely hot, and that energy will boom. It'll condense, it'll turn into a little cloud, and of course, re-evaporate right away. So pretty neat little trick. Well, how does moisture get into the atmosphere? I'm sure you're familiar with the main term, evaporation, but there's another term maybe you're not so familiar with. So get that down. Evaporation, of course, liquid going to gas. Most of it coming, of course, from the oceans and lakes, right? We're called the blue planet because we're mostly covered by water. And then, of course, there's this word, which maybe some of you remember from biology if you took it. If not, it's called transpiration, and that's when plants release moisture to the air. Similar to a human perspiring, a plant transpires, okay? Put those two terms together, and of course, you get this monster word right here, evapotranspiration, and that is all of the water vapor released in the atmosphere from both living and non-living things. And that, of course, is where our humidity ultimately comes from, right? Water evaporating into the air. This chart is in a reference table's properties of water. It goes through the energy required for melting, freezing, vaporization is evaporating, and then, of course, condensing. This unit is joules per gram. So when we do questions, you're going to see that unit J/G. That's what that means, joules per gram. Okay? If you look at a little animation up top, those are water molecules heading into the air, right? Evaporating. Okay, so we'll go through the factors that affect evaporation. The first one, of course, is temperature. And you can see a little steam forming over the lake there and a nice sunny day. Well, bottom line is, of course, the hotter it is outside, the faster evaporation is going to occur. Conversely, the colder it is, the slower it's going to occur. Now, there are other factors involved, but if we're just talking temperature, then yes, higher temperatures will have faster evaporation rates. And I'm sure you've seen that while cooking on the stove. Hopefully you never made this mistake, and hopefully you never will. But if you put a pot of water on the stove with the lid off, of course, you turn the heat on, and then you say, I'll be back in a couple minutes, right, to when the water's boiling. Well, sometimes people forget, and this boiling water evaporates very quickly. And the next thing you know, you got nothing left in the pot. Well, the water kept the pot at a cooler temperature, right? Because water, when it boils, stays at 100 degrees C at sea level. But if the water disappears, now the pot gets a lot hotter. And the heat will travel to the handle, and the handle will start to melt, and it's possible to cause a fire. So if you're cooking, folks, make sure you're just cooking. Don't get distracted doing other things. Very dangerous. Anyways, if it were colder, it would sit there almost forever to evaporate, but heat will speed that up. All right, So what does a graph look like? If temperature increases, the rate of evaporation increases as well. All right, get that in your notes. All right, moving on. Wind is also another factor that affects evaporation rates. And you probably figured it out. The faster the wind blows, right? Put a little fan in front here, and it'll speed things up, right? That little simulation there, if you just leave it alone, yeah, some water evaporates. But if you put a fan in the front, well, then it's going to cause a lot more of those water molecules to enter the air much faster. Okay? So wind velocity, the faster it is, of course, the greater the rate of evaporation. What does that graph look like? Well, if you said direct once again, you are right on the money. That is another direct relationship. Okay? This happens over the Great Lakes. They get this crazy scenario. It's called lake effect snow. And because the winds, the planetary winds we talked about yesterday, come from the west, right? We have the southwest winds. They blow across the lakes. And in the wintertime, that gives more evaporate, make cause for more evaporation, more moisture in the air, higher humidity. And if there's going to be a snowstorm, well, now this constantly feeds that storm. So like we would get 6 or 8 inches, they could get 6 or 8 feet because this wind really speeds up evaporation of water, turns into snow in the wintertime, and it gets dumped. And this occurs in northwest parts of New York State, like Buffalo area, Niagara. They get these crazy lake effect snows. So if you're going to go to school out there, some of the schools are connected with underground tunnels. Because let's face it, 6, 8, 10 feet of snow is not getting shoveled very quickly. So they're not going to cancel school all the time. You're paying a lot of money to go to college. So they connect a lot of the buildings with underground tunnels so they don't have to close school. All right. Anyways, the third factor of evaporation rates is surface area. Which one of these containers has a greater surface area? Well, if you said container B, you are correct. And the greater the surface area is, the faster the water will evaporate, right? More air hits it, it's more spread out, more sunlight can hit more of it, and certainly speeds up the evaporation rate. Okay? So get it down there. Surface area, the more of it that you have, the greater the evaporation rate. What does that graph look like? Well, if you said another direct relationship, you are okay. All right. You can try that at home very easily. Use a big round container and a skinny glass. You got to put the same amount of water in each one, right? That's your control. But you will see this scenario happen where the one that's more spread out will evaporate faster. Okay. And the third one, which a lot of people don't realize, but humidity plays a big role here. If there's already a lot of moisture in the air, well, then you can't put that much more in. Right, for example, on those very humid days, let's say you went for a swim and you want your towel to dry, or you're doing your laundry and you hang it outside to dry. If it's a humid day, it does not dry, right? That water can't evaporate into the air because the air is already full. So that is a biggie right there, right? The amount of moisture in the air, the more humid, the less evaporation. So now look at that graph. Now it's a little different, right? So if there's more moisture in the air already, then you're going to get less evaporation. Okay, a much slower evaporation rate as well. Okay, which one of these two areas would water evaporate the fastest? If you said dry air, of course, you are correct. Dry means little to no moisture and, of course, a lot more evaporation. All right. So what are the factors that affect evaporation at this point? Hopefully you can recall that, right? We have temperature, wind, surface area, and humidity. Okay? You know the deal. You got some questions coming up. Do your best on them. And, of course, we will meet back in the meet to go through them and see how you're doing. All right? Don't forget, get those any delinquent labs out at this point. Make sure you get them in pronto. See you in a bit.